Basically, when you talk about drought, okay, so drought is the opposite of floods, right? Where there is too much of water, too much of rainfall, so we tell it as flood, right? And then when there is lack of rainfall, lack of water, we say that particular area is in the drought-prone area. Correct. So a natural shortfall of precipitation, that is the rainfall water and water resources, to levels that do not meet the uses established for normal conditions. That do not meet the uses established for normal conditions. Now you know that how much rainfall and this water resources are important for the normal activities in our life. Okay, so the shortfall is so much. The precipitation or the water resources shortfall is so much that even the basic uses are not met. Okay, that can be understood as drought is a longer period of deficient precipitation. It's not like that one day you don't get a rainfall and you say it's a drought area or the drought condition. No, it is a longer period of deficient precipitation. Deficient, I mean there is no rainfall or very less rainfall for a longer period, resulting into extensive damage to crops, resulting in loss of yield. So basically the something that is going to get more damage because of the lack of precipitation is the damage to crops. Correct. So this is how the drought-prone areas look like when there is no rainfall, no precipitation. The land looks like a barren land, dry barren land. So this is a maps of our country showing the drought-prone area. So you can see the darker the greenish color, the more extreme condition of drought is observed in those particular areas. See, zone 1, that is extreme, zone 2 severe, zone 3 moderate, and drought free areas are the white colored areas. Okay, so there are you can say different classification of the drought. So depending upon the rainfall deficiency, then soil moisture deficiency and water supply deficiency. So from the diagram itself we can make out, when you talk about meteorological drought, that is drought, that is lack of water due to some meteorological condition, that is rainfall. So when there is rainfall deficiency because of which the drought conditions have occurred, we call it as meteorological drought. If the soil moisture deficiency, okay, so if depletion of the soil moisture during the growing season, a dry situation with 20% probability and rainfall deficiency of more than 25% in drought-prone states, that is called the agricultural drought. Soil moisture, the soil moisture is lost maybe because of the warm conditions over there. Okay, rainfall is one of the reason, and plus the condition there, the area is in such a hot climate area that the soil moisture is immediately lost. So that also becomes very difficult for crop to be grown, and that is called the agricultural drought. Okay, meteorological, I just told you that when the rainfall is low, there is normal precipitation below 25%. Okay, and this hydrological drought, that is water supply deficiency. So what is that? Prolonged meteorological drought and drying of the reservoirs, lakes, streams, rivers, cessation of the stream flows and fall in the groundwater levels. Okay, that is precipitation is low. Basically, the main reason for drought is low rainfall or no rainfall. Okay, it is related to rainfall. But when it is only related to rainfall, it's called meteorological drought. When it is related to precipitation, that is low rainfall, plus drying of the reservoirs, as I told you, if that area is in particular condition where there is too much hot climate area, so you have drying of reservoirs, lakes, streams, cessation of the spring flow. Cessation in the sense a reduction or complete stoppage of the spring flow. Spring flow in the sense when the groundwater is high through different paths, through different channels inside the underground, the groundwater reaches the earth surface. Okay, so that channels are called the spring flows. Okay, so stoppage of the spring flows when the groundwater is low, how will you get those spring flows, how will you get the water rising towards the land? So that is also stopped and falling in the groundwater levels. Okay, and then you have agriculture drought, as I told you, the depletion of the soil moisture along with the less rainfall, of course. Okay, then reported drought events in India over the past 200 years. So these are the like I just shown you the map. Here you have seen the map. Okay, even if extreme drought condition you could see only at a few places, but still these greener areas are also the drought prone areas. Maybe severe, moderate, but still they are in the drought prone areas. Okay, so if you look at the map, our country is actually prone to droughts. So you can see the drought years, reported drought events in India over the past 200 years. So from period 1801 to 1900, so these were the drought years. Similarly, 1901 to 2000, so many were the drought years. Drought years in the sense, in these years, many parts of the India were reported to suffer from drought condition. Correct? Then what are the preventive measures that we can follow in order to prevent or to, you know, mitigate, reduce the impact of this drought? Dams and reservoirs and wetlands to store the water. The more the water you store, okay, the more it will be useful. So dams, reservoirs, wetlands to store the water. Water shade management, wherever there is water is collected, maybe because of the rainfall, maybe because of the streams or the river joining and getting collected somewhere. So whatever naturally the water is getting collected, management of that water that is collected, that is called the watershed management. Water rationing in the sense, when you have to pay bill for the usage of your water, of course people using the water, people will not waste the water, right? So water rationing has to be done so that adequate and sufficient amount only will be used by people. Cattle management, because when you talk about agriculture getting much more affected, okay, agriculture and animal husbandry, that is mostly for the crop growing of the crops, as well as to the farmers having their animals, because they also require water. In these drought prone areas, it is very difficult for them to survive. Okay, so cattle management, proper selection of the crop for drought affected areas. Okay, so that has to be done. Then leveling and soil conservation technique, how you can have the more amount of soil that is permeable. If the soil is permeable, it will absorb a lot amount of rainfall, correct? And it will increase the groundwater level, it will always be moistened. Then reducing deforestation and firewood cutting in the affected areas, because that is one of the reasons which increases the temperature of any area, correct? So reducing deforestation so that the climate will not be a hot climate, more hotter climate. Basically, if it is in the hot prone area, but more hotter, it shouldn't happen. So that could be reduced, that could happen by reducing deforestation, firewood cutting in the affected areas. Alternative land use models for water sustainability, how you can use the land in such a way that water could be used in only adequate amount. Then checking of migration and providing alternate employment. If in the drought prone areas, people, basically when farmers are facing a lot of problem, how you can provide them alternate employment in those particular years, or what you say, period of time when there is drought. Education and training to the people to be given on how to face this drought, and participatory community programs. So all these preventive measures can be followed in the drought prone areas. Then preparedness plan, improvement in agriculture through modifying the cropping patterns and introducing drought resistant varieties of crops. Just I told you, like you can change the crop patterns more, and then more of using of drought resistant areas in those period of drought. Then Management of rangeland with improvement of grazing patterns, introduction of feed and protection of the shrubs and trees, development of water resource system with improved irrigation, development of improved storage, water storage facilities, protection of the surface water from evaporation and introduction of drop irrigation system. So all these things can be followed in relation, because like just now we have seen the type of drought. Along with the precipitation, it is the hot climate also in that particular area, which are the main reasons. So that is why you have to protect the surface water from evaporation. Then introduction to drip irrigation system, actually it is. Then animal husbandry activities can help in mitigation with the use of improved and scientific methods. Then watershed development program. Watershed development program, in the sense, like I just told you, when we talk about watershed management, it is amount of water that is getting stored naturally in a particular area, getting collected. So how to manage that, how to, you know, preserve that. So improve and sustain productivity and production potentials of dry and semi-arid regions of India through adoption of appropriate production and conservation technologies. Meet the needs of local rural communities for food, fuel, fodder and timber. Improve all types of land, that is government, forest, community, private lands falling within a watershed. Then, what is this watershed development program? It is a holistic, a complete approach to improve and develop the economic and natural resource base of dry or semi-arid or fragile regions. In a watershed development program, the watershed is a unit for development rather than political or administrative boundaries. The more and more the water can be collected, like now you see the work of Pani Foundation. You might be a part of it, your relatives might be a part of it, or some known person might be a part of it, or you have seen it on the news also, on your television also. Then how in that Pani Foundation, in rural areas basically, where people, where the main source of income of people is agriculture, and they are more dependent on water for it, of course, water is the main source for it. And when they face this lack of shortage of rainfall, then how they come together and help in storage of the water, how much ever water is received. We don't have to waste the water. We have to manage that water, preserve the how much of the water that is received. So that is actually comes under the watershed development program. See, what are the different watershed development activities? Land development, leveling and terracing, improving the soil quality and productivity and watershed reclamation. Okay, then water development, promote in situ on the site water harvesting, conservation, establish percolation ponds and open wells, tanks, small reservoirs, and improving the water quality. So all this comes under the WDP, that is watershed development program activities. Okay, land development, that is leveling, terracing. I mean, why do you have to do that? So that the surface runoff, the water that is received, should not get runoff, should get percolated inside that soil. Okay, and therefore you have to do this leveling, okay, which would improving the soil quality, so that, like I said, permeable soil we need. Then watershed reclamation, again we improving the watershed areas, more and more water that it could be stored. Then water harvesting, conservation of percolation, open well tanks, small reservoirs, and also improving the water quality. All this comes under watershed development program activities. Then enterprise and activity, that is evolve appropriate farming system, encourage a crop mix of high value and high yield crops. Then social and agroforestry and other income generating activities, like I said, not only on the single income. When this particular session is observed in that area, session of drought, people should be made aware of the different income generating activities also, and how the modern techniques or what patterns could be followed, different modern patterns could be followed in their agriculture and land use system. Okay, like here it is given, encourage the crop mix of high value and higher crops, Okay, so all these activities need to be followed and need to be made people educated about it. Some illustrations, some examples of benefits of watershed development programs, that is replacing the seasonal or annual crops with agro-silvi, agro-horti or silvi-horti systems on hill slopes or degraded lands. That is, benefits are it reduces the soil erosion and arrests the surface runoff. Okay, so like we were talking about, that is the crop patterns, the land use pattern, the type of crops that are being used, okay, that has to be changed, correct? So replacing the seasonal or annual crops, just a second, so when you talk about replacing the seasonal or this annual crops which are normally being grown in that area with agro silvi, in the sense there are certain plants which grow in the forest areas only, so those are called the silvi crops, forest areas. So just having the agricultural crops, you can replace it with mix of agro and forest crops, mix of agro and horti. Agro horti, you know, plants or fruit-based crops, plants. Okay, so you can have agriculture crops and plus you can have flowers or fruit-based plants. Then silvi horti, that is forest silvi, in the sense when you talk about the plants that are grown in the forest. Horti in the sense animal or the plant-based plants. So you can have that combination. Okay, all systems on hill slope and degraded lands. And benefits is it reduces soil erosion and arrests the surface runoff. Like I said in the previous slide itself, you have to arrest that surface runoff. Arrest in the sense, because of the surface runoff, of course you cannot change completely the topography of that particular area. If that particular area is in the sloping region, because of the rainfall, whatever short rainfall you get, no water will be arrested, because it will get runoff from the slope area, and plus because of that runoff the soil erosion will happen, which we don't want, because we want soil to be present there so that groundwater could be increased by the absorption of the soil. So that is why you have to have the crops grown on this slopey area, which will erase the surface runoff, okay, and which will absorb the more amount of water. Okay, then draining water to store excess water runoff in farm ponds or percolation tanks. Benefits, that is improve the groundwater recharge. Okay, farm ponds, percolation tank, where it will be stored and it will be go through the soil and increase the groundwater recharge. Construction of the earthen or vegetative bunds or barriers to surface runoff in watershed. Wherever there is surface runoff, wherever the water is flowing through the slope, like we said, that is growing of the crop, I mean the different types of crops that will arrest the surface runoff, or you can have construction of the barriers, the bunds, like I told you, bunds are also the small barriers only, barriers which can arrest the surface runoff and collect the water. It helps in moisture conservation. Okay, so this was few of the examples that could be followed. And water resource management in drought, from the figures or what you say from the images, we can see this. Better irrigation practices, micro irrigation, drip and sprinkler irrigation. You must have studied this at your school level as well. Directly usage of water rather than having this drip and sprinkler irrigation, which uses sufficient amount and adequate amount of water only. So that has to be followed in the areas which is in the drought prone area, so that the wastage of water, unnecessary wastage of the water, could be reduced and adequate amount of water will be available through this type of irrigation system, correct? Then farm ponds, about 11 to 37% runoff is generated even by the delayed monsoon and should be stored in the farm ponds. This will recharge the groundwater during normal or excessive rainfall year. Understood? That is what I was talking about, the Pani Foundation work also. So it is somewhat, it is the similar type, that is when you are creating ponds in your farm itself. Those are not, I mean, you don't have to construct anything. You are just creating ponds so that it, the water could be stored, the groundwater recharge could be increased. Okay, so that are called the farm ponds. That also comes under this better irrigation practices. Groundwater harvesting and conservation structures. So for that, rooftop harvesting, rainwater harvesting. Correct? So you know this. When you have sufficient area, which we call the catchment area. Now this, for this particular, a bungalow or a building, this particular rooftop is the catchment area. Area which directly catches the water. Okay? So the catchment area is so much, and this water, rather than getting wasted out, it could be used up. That is called the rooftop harvesting, that is rainwater harvesting through the rooftop. Correct. So this water could be collected. Okay. And then you see here, this here you can see one pipeline, or here you can see one pipeline and recharge trench. Okay. So this will help in recharging the groundwater with the help of the rainwater that is connected on the rooftop. Okay, then you have check dams. Like you have, you had farm ponds. Similarly, when you construct, see, this is now constructed one. When you construct the barrier in order to store the water, that is called the check dams. Okay, not the regular type of dams. Okay, it is just the small barriers that are constructed in order to store that water and avoid the flow of water. Percolation tanks, correct? See, it's just that in this check dams you have a constructed barrier, artificially constructed barrier, I mean using the construction materials. And here it's similar like your farm ponds, but farm ponds are the ponds made in the farm itself so that water could be directly used for agriculture. Here, wherever you have space and the water could be collected in that area, percolation tanks like a lake only could be created. Then indirect water conservation techniques. What are the different indirect water conservation techniques? This aim at augmenting the soil moisture retention, okay, holding the soil moisture and preventing the soil erosion and land degradation. Now if you see here, this particular area is a slopy area, okay? If there are no contour bunding, that is called contour bunding, if not done here, directly the precipitation, that is a rainfall that is that falls over this land, there will be a surface runoff and the water won't be collected in that area. Okay, and that will also reduce the soil moisture. Of course, you have plants here, but still, in order to increase the soil moisture retention and avoid soil erosion, which happens due to the surface runoff, this contour bunding, when you construct these bunds over the slope areas, of course, water will fall through this area, but much of the water would be collected. If you see here, much of the water would be collected inside this, and much of the retention, okay, retention of that moisture will happen. Correct. Then surface water management, that is reservoirs, interbasin water transfer, that is interlinking of the river, so that the river interlinks and then goes into some ocean or gets wasted somewhere, or it has to be transferred in order that that water, without getting wasted, it could be stored. Okay, so you see here, the bunds are made, the canals are made, so that the water could be diverted and stored. Okay, there. Depending upon the situation of the area, there should be integrated management proceeded for its effective mitigation approach. Correct? We have now seen so many things that could be followed for management of the watershed. So, depending on the situation of the area, the best practices could be followed. Every household, and community has to become involved in the provision of the water and in the protection of the water resources. And that is the main motto of Pani Foundation also. Every household, every community should come together and help in this water conservation. Soil and water conservation and water harvesting will go a long way towards reducing the misuse of the government funds. In India, 60% of the gross crop area depends upon rain. That is why India agriculture is called a gamble of monsoon. Hence, there is a great necessity to control and mitigate the agricultural drought amidst relevant problems. Correct? So that is why we have to struggle more in this particular field in order to control and mitigate the drought and its relevant problems. Right? So the next disaster that we will go through is cyclone. Okay, so what are cyclones? Cyclones, we had seen, we had heard about it, we have seen in the videos as well. Okay, so cyclone is an intense whirl, okay, the churning or turning around. Okay, so it is an intense whirl in the atmosphere with very strong winds circulating around it in anti-clockwise direction in the northern hemisphere and clockwise direction in the southern hemisphere. Okay, so it are the intense whirl in the atmosphere. Intense whirl of what? The strong winds circulating in anti-clockwise direction in northern hemisphere and clockwise direction in the southern hemisphere. The word cyclone is derived from the Greek word, which means cyclos, which is a cyclos word, and the meaning of is coils of a snake. So how it is the coils of the snake are whirled around, the similar is the cyclone, and that is why the word cyclone was derived from this word cyclos. Now this cyclone has different naming at different places. So it is known as hurricane in the Atlantic and Eastern Pacific, typhoon in the Western Pacific, willy-willies in Australian Sea, and bugges in the Philippines. So it's one and the same, but it has different names at different places. Then cyclones are intense low pressure areas from the center of which pressure increases outwards. The amount of pressure drop in the center and the rate at which it increases outwards gives the intensity of the cyclone and the strength of the wind. Okay, it is the low pressure area at the center and high pressure area at the sides. Okay, so the center of which the pressure increases outwards. Okay, so now criteria followed to classify the cyclone. When you say low, deep, depression, deep depression, cyclonic storm, severe cyclonic storm with a core of hurricane winds. So when you classify this, so it is classified based on the wind speed, because like I said, it is the whirl of the wind and the fast moving wind. Okay, so how fast? So when the wind speed is less than 17 knots, sorry. Now what is 17 knots? The 17 knots. So 1 knot is 1.85 kilometer per hour. So this particular unit name is given as 1 knot. Okay, so when you talk about 1 knot, 17, okay, so that is around some 32 kilometer per hour. Okay, depression, that is 70 to 27 knot, that is 32 to 50 kilometer per hour. Deep depression, that is 28 to 33 kilometer, knots, that is 51 to 62 kilometer per hour. Cyclonic storm, that is 34 to 47 knot, which is around 63 to 88 kilometer per hour. You can calculate also. 1 knot is 1.85 kilometer per hour. So somewhat you will get the value around this. Then severe cyclonic storm with a core of hurricane winds, so that is 48 to 63 knots, which comes around 89 to 118 kilometer per hour. So depending upon the wind speed, the disturbance or the type and the criteria for classification of this cyclone is done. Then mechanism of cyclone. So like I told you, in the cyclone the middle part, okay, is a low pressure zone, and the outer part where the wind is blowing, okay, in the clockwise or anti-clockwise direction, that is in the high pressure zone. Okay, so the eye is the center part. Okay, the eye wall is the side wall that is formed in that particular cyclone, and the rain bands. Okay, and the rain bands, because when the cyclone arises inside, it arises inside the water, right? Okay, because the water, whenever there is the water gets warm, correct, because of the sun rays, and since at warm area the low pressure is generated, because of the warming of the water vapors are released which forms the clouds, correct, and that's what the, because it is a low pressure zone created, when the water gets warm this water vapor is created, correct, and that is why the low pressure zone is formed at the center, and the strong winds, okay, which are cooler winds, okay, at high pressure zone, they have high pressure. When there is cooler winds, like cool temperature, there is high pressure, and wind always flows from high pressure to low pressure, and that is why the wind from the high pressure zone, where there is cooler atmosphere, they will come and circulate this low pressure area, because here the water vapor form is the warm area, low pressure area. Okay, so see here, mechanism of tropical cyclone formation. Now here you see the descending air. If you see this blue arrows, this is air, because air, like I told you, it flows, that is air or wind flows from high pressure zone to low pressure zone. When the middle part, what you say is eye, is in the low pressure zone, because it is on the water surface which is warmer, and where it is warm, it is low pressure zone, and the cooler wind which will be in the high pressure zone, okay, they will descend, because wind will flow from high pressure to low pressure, and therefore you can see the wind blowing inside and descending air, what you say, okay, and these are the spiral rain bands, okay, that are flowing outwards, okay, so this is how the cyclone looks like, okay, so it's not just the wind, it is the rain bands that you see that are formed because of the wind. Okay, then mechanism of the cyclone. A full grown cyclone is a violent whirl in the atmosphere, 150 to 1000 km across, that is width, and 10 to 15 km high, so it is that violent. The central calm region of the storm is called the eye. The central low pressure warm region, calm region, is called the eye. The diameter of the eye varies from 30 to 50 km, and is a region free of clouds and has light winds. Around this calm and clear eye, there is wall cloud region of the storm about 50 km in extent, where this gale winds, the strong winds, thick clouds with torrential rain, thunder and lightning prevail. So around that eye is the eye wall, which is this combination of this strong winds, thick clouds, torrential rain, thunder, lightning, etc. Away from the wall cloud region, the wind speed gradually decreases. Okay, it's only in the cyclone, that is the wall cloud region, where the wind speed is more, and it gradually decreases outside, away from that. The gales give rise to confused sea with waves as high as 20 meters. Because of the strong winds, it is the waves that we see getting disturbed, and they rises. Okay, so this gale, that is the strong wind, give rise to confused sea with waves as high as 20 meters. 20 meter, it swells that travel 1000 miles. Torrential rains, occasional thunder, lightning flashes, all this join this particular cyclone. Through this churn, chaotic sea and atmosphere, the cyclone keeps moving 300 to 500 kilometers in a day to hit and skirt along a coast, bringing with it storm surges. Storm surges in the sense, increase in the sea level. Once the cyclone reaches the higher altitudes, they often change their direction. Once they reach the higher altitude, they often change their direction and move north and northeast, or when it reaches the higher altitude at the south, it moves south and southeast hemisphere. This process is known as the recurvature. Before it recurves, the speed decreases and system remains stationary for a day or so. When it reaches the hemisphere, basically the speed decreases. When two cyclones exist near to each other, they interact and move anti-clockwise with respect to each other. Okay, when there are two cyclones which come near to each other, okay, they move anti-clockwise to each other. In the Atlantic, tracks often execute parabola. So this interaction often forms like a parabola. In India, when cyclones recurve, when this recurvature happens, when it reaches the hemisphere, the higher altitude I mean, when the cyclones recur, they get broken up over the Himalayas, the colder regions, okay, higher altitude regions, and their further eastward movement ceases, that is stops. The naming of the cyclone, as you know, every cyclone has some different name, correct? So we have experienced the Nisarga cyclone also, we have just seen the Tauktae cyclone also, correct? So this naming is given. Cyclones derive their names through a systematic procedure laid down by the World Meteorological Organization and the United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and Pacific. Okay, so now you know how these cyclones derive their names from the procedure given by WMO and ESCAP. Naming of the cyclones began in September 2004. 8 North Indian Ocean countries, that is Bangladesh, India, Maldives, Myanmar, Oman, Pakistan, Sri Lanka and Thailand, have prepared a list of 64 names. Since 2004, the 8 countries have faced around 20 cyclones and more that we have experienced in last 2-3 years as well. The countries take turns in naming the cyclone. So these 8 countries take turns in naming the cyclone. The last 6, I mean few of them, are Nargis, that is named by Pakistan, Rashmi, that is named by Sri Lanka, Khaimuk by Thailand, Nisha by Bangladesh, Bijli by India, Ayla by Maldives, and many more that we have just seen. Now this is a cyclone map of India. Okay, so you can see the wind speed given here. Tamil Nadu. Basically, the colored areas apart from the yellow colored areas are the cyclone prone areas. Okay, and this apart from the yellow part. So, the blue part, that is Tamil Nadu, where the wind speed is 255 km per hour. The red part, that is the Andhra Pradesh, okay, where the wind speed is 263 km per hour. Okay, this dark green part, which is Orissa, which is where the wind speed is 259 km per hour. Then this violet, or what you say, purple part, that is the West Bengal, 215 km per hour. And the light green part, Saurashtra and Konkan, that is 223 km per hour is the mostly the wind speed in these areas. Okay, and these are the cyclone prone areas of our country. Then what are the principal dangers of a cyclone? Gales and strong winds. Gales, that means the strong winds. Okay, it damages the installations, dwellings, communication system, trees, etc., resulting in loss of life and property. Torrential rains, too much of rain that causes river floods. I mean, the rains associated with these cyclones. Storm surges or high tidal waves. Storm surges also means when there is increase in the height of the sea, that is called the high tidal waves. A storm surge is an abnormal increase of sea level near the coast caused by severe tropical cyclone. As a result, sea water inundates, that is comes inside the low-lying areas of coastal regions, drowning the human beings and the livestock, the animals, eroding beaches and embankments, destroying vegetation and reducing the soil fertility. So these are the principal dangers of a cyclone. So now you see in this picture, what is a storm surge? When there is a normal high tide, okay, mean sea level, low tide and high tide. But when there is a storm surge because of the cyclonic action, the sea waves rise above this high tide, see this storm tide. Okay, and damage is the property. Then how high will the storm surge be? Every cyclone that affects the coast produces a storm surge, increasing the sea level. But not all storm surges rises to dangerous level. The height of the surge depends upon the intensity of the cyclone. As the wind increases, the sea water is piled higher and the waves on top of the surge are taller. Okay, more the intensity, okay, more the higher will be the storm surge. The forward speed of the cyclone. The faster the cyclone crosses the coast, the more quickly surge builds up and more powerfully it strikes. The more near, I mean, when cyclone travels, okay, if it crosses the coast with higher speed, the more will be the increase in the sea level near the coast, of course. The angle at which the cyclone crosses the coast. Local zones of enhanced surge in areas such as narrow inlets and bays. That is also one of the reason, that is intensity, the forward speed of the cyclone with which it arises the coast, angle at which the cyclone crosses. Okay, these are the reasons that how much the rise in the sea level will be. Then shape of the sea floor. Surge builds up more strongly if the slope of the seabed at the coast is shallow. So of course, when near the seabed, the depth of the sea is low, that is shallow, the storm surge will build in that particular area. Past history indicates that loss of life is significant when surge magnitude is 3 meters or more. Okay, from when you have seen the diagram now. High tide level is one level and above that is the storm surge, increasing the sea level. If the magnitude is more than 3 meters, it is dangerous condition, okay? But when it is more than 5 meters, it is catastrophic, deadly condition. Surge prone coasts of India. Vulnerability to storm surges is not uniform along the Indian coast, correct? East coast of India are most vulnerable to high surges, that is the North Orissa, West Bengal coast, Andhra Pradesh coast between Ongole and Machilipatnam, Tamil Nadu coast south of Nagapattinam. The west coast of India is less vulnerable to storm surges. Okay, storm surges, that is increase in the sea level, higher increase. So that is west coast of India is less vulnerable to storm surges, that is Maharashtra coast, north of Harnai and adjoining South Gujarat coast, and the coast belt around the Gulf of Bombay, the coastal belt around the Gulf of Kutch. Okay, then how to avoid the catastrophe? So effective cyclone disaster prevention and mitigation plan is required to avoid this particular disaster. A cyclone forecast and warning service, that now we usually get it. Rapid dissemination, that is spreading of warnings to the government agencies, marine interests like the ports, fisheries, shipping, and to the general public. Specifically, more to the people which are dependent on the sea and which live near the sea. They have to be informed very prior, and also to the general public. Organizations to construct cyclone shelters in the cyclone prone areas and ready machinery for evacuation of the people to safer areas. As you know, when there is cyclone and the storm surge and everything, most important thing when you get the early warning sign is evacuation of those people from that cyclone prone areas. And you have to have ready equipment for evacuation of the people to safer areas. Okay, then community preparedness at all levels to meet the emergencies. Okay, then cyclone warning. Two-stage warning scheme is followed in cyclone warning. The first stage warning is known as a cyclone alert, which is issued 48 hours in advance of the expected commencement of the adverse weather over the coastal areas. Okay, that is called the cyclone alert, 48 hours in advance to the commencement of such a weather. And the second stage warning is known as a cyclone warning, which is issued 24 hours in advance. So you have cyclone alert and cyclone warning. Cyclone alert is prior to 48 hours and cyclone warning is issued 24 hours in advance. Both cyclone alert and warning messages are passed to the All India radio stations for repeated broadcast. Then how high winds this damage the buildings. Okay, so in short, I'll just tell you that how this high winds because of the cyclone damage the buildings. So contrary to popular belief, few houses are blown over. Instead, they are pulled apart by winds moving swiftly around and over the building. This lowers the pressure on the outside and creates a suction on the walls and roof, effectively causing the equivalent of an explosion. Whether or not a building will be able to resist the effect of the wind is dependent not so much upon the materials that are used, but the manner in which they are used. Common belief is the heavier the building, such as those made of concrete block, are safer. Correct? It is a common belief that whenever there are strong winds, if the construction is of a higher material, a high weight material, okay, so it is not, it is safe, we say. But the truth is, well-built and properly engineered masonry house offers a better margin of safety than other types of building. It's not just the material, it's a myth that only material is responsible to deal with this wind. It is how you construct, how engineered practices are followed in order to deal with such high winds. See, damaging effects of cyclone on houses. Due to high wind pressure and improper connection of the house to the footing, it can be blown away. Okay, so what is the use of the construction material that is being used if it is not proper connected to the footing? Then, roofing material not anchored and can be blown away, not properly anchored. Lightweight veranda, okay, veranda roofs are more susceptible to damage due to high wind speed. If the construction material used in the house is heavier, but what is the use if the veranda is of lightweight and it is going to get damaged easily? Then when cyclones are accompanied with heavy rain for a long duration, the building can be damaged due to flooding. So you know that. So when choosing the site for your house, consider the following. Through cyclonic storms always approach from the direction of the sea. Though cyclonic storms approach from the direction of the sea towards the coast, wind velocity and direction relative to a building remain random due to rotating motion of the high velocity wind. Correct? So in non-cyclonic region where the predominant strong wind direction is well established, the area behind a mound or a hillock should be preferred. In cyclonic storm, it is not predictable to you cannot predict the wind velocity and its direction. But in non-cyclonic region, you have the wind direction. So there has, you know, it is well established this direction of the wind. So area behind a mound or a hillock should be preferred. Okay. Similarly, a row of trees planted to upwind will act as a shield. Row of trees. Influence of such a shield will be over a limited distance, only 8 to 10 times the height of the trees. Okay, the trees should also not be near to the houses. 8 to 10 times the height of the trees should be the distance between the trees and the houses. A tree broken close to the house may damage the house. Also, hence the distance of the tree from the house may be kept 1.5 times the height of the tree. Okay, the influence that is of the shield should be 8 to 10 times the height of the trees, and the distance at which the construction to be done should be 1.5 times the height of the tree. See, when choosing the site for your house, consider the following. No shielding from high wind due to absence of barrier, and shielding from high wind due to these barriers. Correct? Then, see here. In hilly areas, construction along the ridges should be avoided since they experience increase in the wind velocity, whereas valley experiences lower speeds in jungle. So you know that, correct? See here also. When you have storm surges, the construction should be such that the houses are at higher elevations. Rather than having such a road type arrangement, you should have a cluster arrangement so that wind could be blocked in all the directions. These roofs could be attached, the lightweight roofs which gets blown off, okay, they should be completely attached properly. Okay, and then you have these general considerations, that is avoid overhanging roofs, avoid the low pitch roofs. Okay, then slope has to be proper. Okay, this is called the hip roof. If it's a flat roof, that is called the low pitch roof. So avoid low pitch roof, use a hip roof or the high pitch roof. Avoid this overhanging roofs, avoid openings which cannot be securely closed during a cyclone. Proper foundations. You should have a proper safe bearing capacity while you have. You should know the proper safe bearing capacity of the soil when you are going to construct the foundation. And certain do's and don'ts you have for the cyclones. So that in the last module also you have about the various disasters and do's and don'ts. So we will go through that in that last module. Okay.